Deb, wave. She came from Australia. We've got people from Florida, from Connecticut, from Virginia, New York.
Don't forget New
Massachusetts.
Hampshire.
Where else?
New Hampshire.
Tennessee. Yes. Bridgeport. And Kay technically is from Kitty's technically from China, right? You live in China. So this has been, I just want to do a quick intro here. This has been an amazing, amazing, strange and wild last few months. And we've had like a tremendous loss and we've had some tremendous wins. So we're going to start out first to honor, pardon me if I get choked up. you know that, I can't. Well, have Fern come up. Fern, sorry.
Yeah.
I'm melting already. Okay.
Hi everybody, my name is Bernadette, and Sharon asked if I would speak about our friend, Patrice Diane Messina, who we lost on May 26th of this year. The empty chair and the rose represents her being here, and hopefully she's with us. I first met Patrice in July 2010, right after the June meeting of that year. Online, she found our MacDonald-Eddy Yahoo group, that was Sharon's originally, and it was an offshoot of the club. She said she loved Jeanette and Nelson, a love inherited by her mom, who used to sing their songs. Patrice soon became a valued member and friend, and enjoyed the interactions and the information from everyone on the group. She also became a great researcher for Jeanette and Nelson, too. Patrice worked at Disney in management and administrative capacity, but her first love was always writing. She had written two episodes of The New Twilight Zone. The one in 1982 is best known, was titled Grace Note, which still can be seen on YouTube. She also won the Disney Writing Fellowship Award, and Patrice had many good friends in her writers group that still have shows running on TV today. She had talent and a lovely persona, funny and a lovely soul. In 2012, she was diagnosed with cancer, and this battle went on for 3 years. She was very courageous and even went to work at Disney while still enduring chemo. During her time on the group, she began coming to the LA meetings here and got to know Sharon. At some point, she knew Sharon had an outline script for a movie about Jeanette and Nelson. She asked Sharon if she could write a complete script. Patrice worked on this script, even though weakened by this terrible illness, to finish it. She was very determined and did complete it. Patrice was not all work. She had a fun and kind side too. The story I'm about to tell you, I'd like to share. At some point after joining the MacDonald-Eddy group, she went to visit Nelson's grave at Hollywood Forever. She decided to bring some holy sage with her and was waving it all around Anne Franklin Eddy's grave. She wanted to try and ease any evil or bitterness around her and try and clear the karma of that bitter, bitter woman. Anyway, she thought the cemetery custodians thought she was nuts. Or, as she said, often happens, they're making a movie there. That was so Patrice. Sometimes God picks the flower that is still in full bloom. Sometimes the rosebud chosen we feel is picked too soon. I can't tell you how glad I am. what would turn out to be my last phone conversation with Patrice, I was able to say, I love you. And she said, I love you too. Those were her very last words. We were proud to know you, kiddo. You were missed by us all. Someday I hope we will see the Sweethearts movie with Patrice's name along with Sharon's in the credits.
Of you who don't know, Bernadette is the gal who first, before social media really took off, she ran our Yahoo group and she's in charge of our Facebook groups. And thank you, Bern. It's not an easy job. Yeah, Patrice came to me and said I would like to take a stab at writing the script, and I said, okay, let's get together and show me what you have in mind. And we met over at Market City Cafe in Burbank, and she went over and she seemed to get a total grasp of all the different aspects, because this is not a story that's in black and white. There's shades of gray. Everything that looks like it's one way is not always another. Somebody who looks like a villain can sometimes not be a villain, or, well, yes, they are, but you know, they have their own motivation. And, you know, we were sitting and talking, and I thought, well, that'll work okay. And in the middle of eating, she said, oh, my stomach. And she excused herself and went to the bathroom, and this flash came through my head, and I went, oh, no, please. You know, she's just starting this project. Let it not be that. And it turned out it was that, you know. So it was a pretty terrible kind of ovarian cancer that she had. And so I tried to help her at various points with the script, and certain times she said, I don't think I can finish it, and then she'd say, no, I want to finish it, or would you fix this for me, I'm too weak to write. And then back in February, at the end of February, she said, I think I have one more thing I want to say, and she added a scene, and then she said, I'm done. And like, and that was the end of February. So, you know, she kind of knew she wouldn't make it to see it happen, but
she'll see it. Don't worry.
She'll see it. Anyway, on to happier things. And it's kind of interesting because since she was gone, just these amazing things have come forward, and she would be thrilled to know everything that's been happening these last couple of months. But first of all, I want to introduce some special guests today, and that's going to be the second part of the next part of what we're doing today. I'd like to introduce the grandson of Woody Van Dyke. He's here, Woody the Fourth. He's here with his wife, Brooke, and his daughter, Allie. Regards to Dad.
I will say.
And in honor of Woody coming, we were talking about, we spent a lot of time re-looking at things in terms of the screenplay, and the feedback that I got from several people, including some of the people that worked on Twilight Zone with Patrice, was that their favorite person in the whole story was Woody. The way he,
yes.
Because he kind of represented the times and what they went through, and he was the voice of conscience in an era where nobody wanted to look at the idea of war, because God forbid we'll lose the overseas market. You know, it's all about box office. And he was their friend, and we have Jeanette after 1939 only because he saved her life. So we wouldn't even have the later films or anything else. And I guess they meant a lot to him, since he kind of directed his own funeral and wanted them there. So I thought what we should do was, and I got some help to put this together, and my friend Judy Burns, who met Dad, she wrote for Star Trek, as you know, and she spoke at our last meeting. And she happened to be in New York last week, and so I had her help we'd sat down, I'd sat down with Bern and C originally to work out like what clips we might show, because I'm sure you've seen all the films 100 times, but the little touches that were Woody that made him special as a director, and the little bloopers and the little outtakes, the things that he left in that if you study the scripts, you see they're not there, or even if they are scenes that are there where, you know, Jeanette Nelson does something funny and Jeanette cracks up and it totally breaks character, and that's the thing that brings them to life. And that's what he did with all the films he did, the Thin Man films, all of them. He brought out that tremendous charisma between his actors. And so, Judy, we sat up one night till 2 a.m. on the computer and went over what the clips were, and we consulted with Katie, and she put it together. She did the actual physical putting together of it, and Judy pulled the clips out, and I sat there and kind of wrote, put it, kind of said, let's do this and that, and we got it whipped together in time. So I guess now we're going to show it, right? We need to take the lights down and close that door.
Your omelet.
Now, is that nice? Think of all the trouble and discomfort those hens experienced to lay those eggs. And with one gesture...
For the last time, get out.
Here, you're tired. Sit down. Relax. Oh, Blue Eyes, I'm sorry. I didn't mean to be that informal. I really am sorry. I'll tell you what you do. You push me down.
I'll call the police and push you out.
Poor Blue Eyes. Because, you see, I'm the police. That's love.
So we're still on the subject of love, are we?
Don't you like it?
No, I don't.
Well, anytime I say anything you don't like, you just cross your fingers and hold them up to me.
Like that?
Like that.
And you'll stop?
And I'll stop. What about...
Oh, that?
Hmm. You know, I'm always cooking more of these things than I can eat. Seems a shame to throw this stuff away.
Don't!
Are you hungry?
Yes.
But these are beans.
I don't care.
Want some tea?
Yes, please.
Sugar?
No, thanks.
Lemon?
Mm-hmm.
Fresh out of lemon.
I've never tasted anything better in my life.
Here, let me fix that for you.
What?
This right here.
Oh, thanks for the coat.
That's all right.
What is that? I heard it before.
Just an Indian.
Makes you feel kind of funny, doesn't it?
Listen. That's his girlfriend.
What is it, a signal between them?
It's an old Indian legend. Once upon a time, there was an Indian who loved an Indian girl of a different tribe. And their families were enemies, sort of a Romeo and Juliet affair. And that was supposed to be their call to each other.
What happened to them?
Well, their families found out about them, and they were both sentenced to die.
Oh.
The Indians say that their spirits still live in the happy hunting ground. And when a lover gives that call, they echo it, sending it on till it reaches the one he loves.
Lovely, isn't it?
But if when you hear a mile of call ringing clear, and I hear your answering echoes so near,
you're cute, you're terribly sweet.
Now we're getting somewhere.
While we sit by and smile. And sigh. You just repeat, repeat, repeat.
And how you hate it.
Thank you.
that is.
She's thick with thorns beset,
and nature when she breathes of love speaks through the violet. I bring a breath.
A kiss upon each petal, my lips are sweet with dew.
The one who sends this message would whisper soft to you, I love you.
No, mademoiselle. He'll never forgive himself for having missed your visit.
You don't mind if I wait here for him?
I beg you to. Please be seated.
Thank you.
Chocolate, mademoiselle?
Yes, thank you.
Milk?
If you think so.
Sweet?
Yes, of course.
Thank you.
Unbelievably so. Hold still.
Oh, darling, I'm not potatoes.
I may be going home a wreck, but I'm going home a romantic wreck.
The Gardner. An operetta by Carl Linden. Dedicated to my dear wife, Shari.
I should add, who hummed the wrong notes and set me right. Who had confidence when I had fears. Believed when I doubted. It's been a long time, and it hasn't been easy for you.
It's been a beautiful time.
Now it's going to be really wonderful. But I'm a very busy man. I've got a lot of big ideas, big plans.
Here you are. Hurry along.
Now, give me a kiss for luck.
There. That's a very lucky kiss. I took special pains with it.
How do you do?
Happy birthday, Count Palafi.
Thank you very much.
The pleasure was all mine.
Could I get you something? Some champagne?
No. No, thank you. I'll just sit over here and look on. Thank you.
I have to tell you about a little adventure we had the other day, because some of the group here have never been to Los Angeles, so they wanted to make the rounds and go see the various, you know, landmarks and the graves. And while we were over at Forest Lawn, I said, we've got to go over and see Woody. So we did that. I don't know if you've been over there recently or at all, but we had to buck all the traffic from Michael Jackson's crowd, because that was the day that he had passed. So we will go over to the area where he is, and there's people dressed as Michael Jackson and all kinds of corners and flowers and tributes and all this going on. So that was very Hollywood, right? And we got over there and we found it, and it was way up on the top in near the ceiling, close, second one down on the right. And so Maria, who just stepped out for a second, had bought a rose and an American flag and put it together to put there. But the problem was we couldn't get it there because the little holder for the flower holder was not there. So, to make a long story short, as is our total irreverent way, this is probably the most, you know, loosest and funnest group of fans you'll ever meet of anybody. We hauled over the security guards. They ended up having to move the bench sitting in front of it and bring guys over and bring up like a big one of those ladder things and go up there, what do you call it? The hydraulic lift.
Oh,
and
wow.
They fixed the niche up there and they put it, and here is a picture of finally the way it should be. Remember when I first came on the scene, the upstart, and I said, oh, you know, Blossom asked me to write a book, and, you know, by the way, her birth date's 1903, Blossom told me, and I'm like, oh no, it's 1907, you know, and look at her crypt, and look at her driver's license, and look at this, and, you know, so right away I was like, bad news. But anyway, so we were polite for some years, but in the end, it just became either we're going to tell the truth or we're not going to tell the truth. And you couldn't be in that group and tell the truth because they didn't much like Nelson. They felt that Jeanette had all the talent and Nelson had none. And that, you know, she dragged them along on, you know, and in reality, the president of that club had wanted to take over the Nelson fan club, and he didn't want her to be the president. So the result was now she liked Jeanette, and she ran the Jeanette Club. Anyway, we found out in these last couple of months that, well, Clara had passed on. Tessa has Alzheimer's and is in a nursing home, and her family decided to have someone who sells estates come in and clean out the house, which was going to go for auction, and sell everything there. And And the bottom line was they were on salary from Gene Raymond all their lives. Tessa still receives a check every month. And these are people who when any biographers went to them, they said, oh, there's no evidence ever that Nelson or Jeanette ever had a romance, ever. You know, we've never seen any documentation to that effect. So anyway, in the last few weeks, certain things have come up for auction, which they had in their possession all those years and somehow escaped being trashed. A big mistake. But anyway, thank God for us, they survived. And what I want to do, first of all, before Maria comes up, one of the things was Jeanette's book of recipes that she cut out or hand wrote or whatever, and Mary Lynn Grana won it. And thank you. And she kindly let me, we had it scanned. We're going to make it available for everyone. And Dawn did a cover for the book. Her recipe book was in leather. It looks just like this. So. We put together a cover, and it should be available soon. And we're going to try to make these things available and keep getting some of the important documents that come up, because it's not possible to get everything, but it isn't possible to get things that are important to us. So I'm going to have Maria come up, and she will give you the saga about something at which, believe it or not, we solved the mystery last night about 1 a.m. in the morning that nobody here has heard about. We haven't even had time to tell anybody. So let's welcome Maria Escano.
Sorry.
beg your indulgence if I sound nervous. I already had a bathroom break, so. But this is a nice story. On June 2nd this year, a very significant auction on eBay ended with our club winning a letter written by Nelson Eddy to Jeanette MacDonald. It was nerve-wracking. It was a nerve-wracking experience. Heart palpitating and heart-stopping process, but it pulled it off. Coming off the night before with an equally suspenseful win from eBay of the personal desk diary of Jeanette by a trio of Angela, Katie, and myself, the price went really high, but we needed to get it. The winning bid was $8,977.52. We had not fully recovered from the shock, and we're not really prepared to finance another auction of this magnitude. So when Nelson's letter came up for the final auction, I had mentioned to Sharon that this is a very important letter. Of course, she knows that, and would surely go pretty expensive. As other people would like to get it and bury it into obscurity to continue the unsuccessful cover-up of the great love between Jeanette MacDonald and Nelson Eddy. And so Sharon put out the word that we needed the financial help ensuring that our group will get this letter or it will never see the light of day. And like the dedicated fans that you are, the response was overwhelming. And before I continue, let me thank those who opened their wallets to help finance this auction. But why did we move heaven and earth to get this letter? Why is it so important? Sharon is allowing me to read her blog in order to give you the background story surrounding the circumstances relevant to this letter. So she writes, after all these decades and all the hundreds of original handwritten letters that were no doubt torn up or reportedly burned, one little old letter slipped through and was just sold at auction. And what a letter. In it, he calls Jeanette an extravagant wretchess. And just to clear up the definition of wretches, a wretch is someone who is a poor, unfortunate thing or a scoundrel, and he's calling her the girl version. Or maybe he's mixing it up, calling her a wretch and a princess. Like a special nickname he calls her when he lovingly scolds her or when she annoys him. Whatever reason he calls her that, it is a loving nickname. Once again, this letter was found among Jeanette MacDonald's boxed up belongings, and surprise, surprise, these items were in the possession of Clara and Tessa. In the Topeka home they shared, they shared the two women who ran Jeanette's largest fan club back starting in the last years of Jeanette's life. They were the keepers of the flame for the Jeanette and Jean blissful marriage and eventually made sure every one of their magazine covers featured a photo of the happy couple, happy. They were, in case you didn't know, on lifetime salary from Jean Raymond. And they did their jobs well. But what you should know is this. They denied any relationship ever between Jeanette and Nelson. And they made sure that anyone who came to them asking about it were told no such documentation existed. In addition, they paraded out the happy Jeanette Jean photos to show how amazing that marriage was. In one regard, perhaps you can't totally blame the phony pretense, because certainly Jeanette, Nelson, Jean, Blossom, and others towed the party line for the public, press, and those club publications. Irritating as it may seem now, all of them politely played out their politically correct roles for decades. Some background to this letter. Just a few months earlier, Nelson proposed marriage to Jeanette at Lake Papo. She accepted, and then there was the ugly breakup. For details of what happened, read Sweethearts. But in essence, Nelson was so very, very, very hurt, and certain he was well rid of Jeanette, who seemed to care more about her career than her feelings for him. Yet, Nelson couldn't help himself. He loved her and turned her like a sickness, quotation marks, that he couldn't get over. And she loved him. That was never the issue with them. The love and desire was there. So the ex-sex was inevitable. And by December 1935, Nelson missed their personal relationship dreadfully and wanted Jeanette to travel with him on his upcoming 1936 tour, so he wouldn't be alone. That would have meant her canceling or postponing the film San Francisco. They quarreled about this and his desire to have his woman at his side, while Jeanette claimed she could successfully balance both marriage to him and her career. From this excerpt from Sweethearts, which Sharon wrote 21 years ago, we learn what happened in December of 1935. In desperation, Jeanette finally arranged to see Nelson alone and tried to resolve things with him. They hashed out things over and over between periods of lovemaking, trying to find a way a union between them could work. This marathon lasted for over 27 hours. Endless hours of discussion and arguments and lots of tears, mostly Jeanette's. Finally, they had to agree that it would never work. They loved each other and they needed each other, but they were too similar. Neither one was willing to give an inch or sacrifice their career goals. I used to think that love was the most powerful emotion, Nelson said bitterly years later. But I found out it wasn't. Pride is the greater emotion. In the end, they decided to part as friends, knowing they would love each other always, but determined to break the spiritual and sexual bond. The romance, as far as either believed, was over forever. And yet, on Christmas Day, what was Nelson doing? Partying? Or taking time to sit down and think about Jeanette and write her a touching letter, blurbing out like a lovesick schoolboy, that despite his attempt to be casual and just friends, he was still hopelessly in love with her. This man was 34 years old, folks, and he already knew that he would always be devoted to you all his life, as indeed he was. For those who can't read the scrawl, this is what he states in the letter dated Christmas 1935. Dearest Jeanette, thank you. It is beautiful, and I appreciate it more than I
are an extravagant wretchess, but I love you and will always be devoted to you. Best Christmas and New Year's thoughts to you. Gratefully and fondly, your Nelson. By the way, Christmas was an emotional and reflective for Nelson Eddy. Don't forget that he later broke up with Jeanette at Christmas time once again in the 40s, feeling he didn't deserve to be with her anymore because he couldn't get a divorce. This is Sharon saying, I have never heard of this letter, but to see how perfectly it fits in Nelson's torn emotions at that time, spending passionate hours with her, and then determining that it would not work. Well, this is the Nelson you see here. So it's a couple of weeks, perhaps, after their brief reconciliation. He's already going through withdrawals from her and showing what a mixed-up young man he was emotionally about her. Unfortunate that he was so stubborn and didn't listen to his mother, Isabel, who wisely observed in her memoirs, I had never seen Nelson so happy. As I looked at her, meaning Jeanette, I thought how safe a man would be with her. Despite any career with this girl, a marriage vow would always come first. Alas, my son did not believe this, and so the gods forever ruled his peace away. Folks, here it is in Nelson's handwriting. The answer is yes. He was hopelessly in love with Jeanette MacDonald. So I welcome you to shout it to the rooftops. To the next person or publication you come across who tries to deny the Jeanette Nelson romance, feel free to share this letter. I have copies, by the way. From the grave, both Nelson and Jeanette are speaking now to us, and in an ironic twist, their truths are revealed from those who lied and sought to hide the facts. But no more. We are vindicated and validated, and my thanks to all who helped uncover the truth over these decades. Note, I have to read this. The back quotes and book passages are from Sweethearts, copyrighted 1994, 2001, 2014 by Sharon Rich. Okay, just to show you how they can get back together again quickly. This photo was taken a few months after when Nelson came back from his tour. Here they are, happily attending the play Maytime, holding hands while visiting backstage. I have to tell you something. When I saw this photo on the internet, it was cut this way. It was cut here. So you would never see that holding hand. Unfortunately for me, I won it on eBay. and you can see the hand holding that was cut away. Anyway, okay, last night I showed Sharon the letter for the first time, I mean the original, and we were scrutinizing, smelling, dissecting, and discussing the possible real message that the emotion, the message emotion the letter tried to convey. Also, we were speculating as to what gift Jeanette might have given him that he was referring to, as it is beautiful. Lots of suggestions have been offered, such as cufflinks, high tack, jewelry, saddle, pipes, pewter, items to add to his collection, etc. All of a sudden, Sharon said, oh, what about the painting of her? She got very excited. Yes, she gave him a painting of her as she was in Nori Marietta. Nelson did paint her, but this was something that Jeanette had asked someone to paint her.
Sharon said that when Nelson moved Isabel from her beach house, Nelson also moved his furnishings and personal effects to the new house, where he would maintain his own suite, consisting of a bedroom, study, and bathroom. Sharon remembered that in Isabel's memoirs, she described what the new study looked like, and she copied that description word for word. She quickly looked in her Kindle of Sweethearts, in her little smartphone, and read the following from Sweethearts chapter 22. And who I'm referring to was not allowed over to Isabel. Privately, they were not on speaking terms, but were socially polite when in public together at Nelson's concert or radio appearances. Had Anne visited Isabel's home, she would be enraged, for her husband's study was a virtual shrine to her hated rival. Large oil painting of Jeanette as Naughty Marietta hung on the wall, and in parentheses, a Christmas gift from Jeanette.
Wow.
Yeah, I know. The bookshelves displayed their records, stills, and picture albums. All the letters and cards she'd ever sent him, he kept. Nelson had a movie projector in the room. His film collection included San Francisco, which he loved for Jeanette's opera scenes and smiling through. There you are. This shrine must have been moved from house to house whenever Nelson transferred his mother. Even though the description of this virtual shrine to Jeanette was written by Isabel in 1945, after she moved from the beach house in Malibu to North Palm Drive, who is there to say that it was not given in 1935? I don't think any other gift would have elicited such an emotional response from Nelson, except such a precious gift, something of herself, and the cost of commissioning a painter for Nelson to call her extravagant. And you know Jeanette, she's the penny painter. This letter, the original, will be properly preserved professionally and will be donated to a museum or university library with the stipulation that it be displayed and not just filed into oblivion. Nelson sang in I Married an Angel, "I want the world to know I love my angel so." Well, Nelson, your wish has finally come true.
Final weeks of filming. When Nelson storms into her dressing room demanding she immediately announce her divorce from Jean Raymond and declare her intention to marry him. She tries to reason with him, pleading that as soon as the film is finished, she will make the announcement. They have a terrible fight, and he tells her, "You'll never change," storms back out, and on January 19th, in a drunken stupor, elopes to Las Vegas with Anne Franklin. The next day, the word spreads like wildfire over MGM's sound stages. Jeanette hears the news, screams, and runs off the set. Woody, nearby, also hears about it and immediately checks on to Jeanette to find she's locked herself in her dressing room. He kicks down the door, discovers she's taken an overdose, and saves her life. The affection Woody had for both of his kids was heartfelt and genuine. He was truly one of the good guys in their story. Here's an adorable introduction by Woody and Jeanette from her 1937 Vic's Open House radio program.
And now, Jeanette, will you do me a favor and sing one of my favorite songs for me, huh?
Certainly, Van. I bet I know which one you'll ask for.
Mm-hmm.
Joseph, play Mighty Like a Rose, please. Right, Van?
That's right, honey.
Next slide. last year, yeah, that's just a clip. There's more on YouTube if you want to hear the whole thing. Last year, Katie and I made several research trips to the Library of Congress. The Motion Picture Broadcasting and Recorded Sound Division. Staff was wonderful and very eager to help. They just love geeks like us, and we were very grateful for their help. I also wanted to say thank you to Sharon Rich for her guidance and determination to tell the truth of their story. She is an inspiration, and everything we've discovered supports her years of research and interviews. She, too, is one of the good guys. Sharon pointed us in the right direction, and we were able to acquire a recording of the January 22, 1939 broadcast of the Chase and Sanborn program. She tried to prepare us for what we were going to hear, but to say we were shaken to the core is an understatement. The rawness of Nelson's performance on that show just 3 days of his marriage, after his marriage, will rip your heart out. It was pretty heavy stuff, which Katie did an excellent job of covering in detail on her blog. On a lighter note, I have to share this. We were doing some later research in another reading room, and we came across countless articles about an auto accident that Sidney Franklin Jr. had with Nelson's car. Confirming again what Sharon accurately reported in Sweethearts, that it resulted in a ton of bad publicity for Nelson, and he was very angry. The woman whose car his stepson hit sued everyone, Sid Jr., Sid Sr., Ann, Nelson, the car, everyone. The suit claimed her vehicle was assertively struck by the Eddy machine. Well, you can imagine the field day Katie and I had with that one. Forevermore, any report of Nelson misbehaving a female will result in one of us declaring the Eddy machine has assertively struck again. I think Katie's to it. Smartphone actually has that on smart text or something. She just types in Eddy and she comes up. Back in Sound Booth 15, it's 3 days after his elopement, and we hear Edgar Bergen, Charlie McCarthy, Don Amici, Dorothy Lamour throw a little surprise celebration for the returning bridegroom. Dorothy had to drag Nelson to the mic, and he blows them off as the wedding march falls flat with a terse comment, "I must have the wrong script." His tone and the music selection for the rest of the show ranges from the subdued to the downright morose. He's not singing well, and this is just a short clip of the intro. You can go to MacDonald-Eddy.com for a link to the entire program. Just a warning, it's not pleasant listening.
The makers of Chase and Sanborn coffee, the superb blend you know is fresh, present the Chase and Sanborn Hour, and your host, Don Amici. This is Don Amici bringing greetings to all of you from our regulars and from our very special guests, Claudette Colbert, Frank Buck, and Sterling Holloway. We hope that you will all enjoy our show and that throughout the week you remain our friends as well as friends of Chase and Sanborn.
Oh, sure.
Here's a happy, hearty hello from...
Hello, Mr. Amici.
Hello, Charlie.
Have you got it, Mr. Amici?
Yes, I have it, Charlie.
That's good. Continue.
A happy, hearty hello from Edgar Bergen.
Have you got it, Mr. Bergen?
Yes, I have it, Charlie.
Good. Continue, Mr. Amici.
From Dorothy Lamour.
Have you got it, Dottie?
You bet I have, Charlie.
Okay, continue, Mr. Amici.
From Robert Armbruster and the Chase and Sanborn Orchestra.
Have you got the stuff, Maestro?
I certainly have, Charlie.
Okay. Good. Continue, Amici.
And, of course, from Nelson Eddy.
Nelson Eddy. Oh, yeah, Nelson Eddy. Go get him, Dottie. Go get him.
I'm on my way, Charlie. Come on, Nelson.
Paging Nelson Eddy.
Come on, Nelson.
Yeah.
Well, have you got it, boys?
I must have the wrong script.
Let him have it. They're right.
Nelson, I guess you know that this shower of rice brings with it for both you and the very lovely Mrs. Eddy the congratulations and best wishes of all of us. And that means from all of us here, all of us at Chase and Sanborn, and I'm sure everybody listening. Well, what is...
Earlier this year, I obtained Jeanette's own script for Broadway Serenade. And in comparing it to the other scripts that also belong to her, that I was able to review, from I Married an Angel, Three Daring Daughters, and The Sun Comes Up, what immediately struck me was it looked so pristine. She'd not even written her name on the front of it. There are no notations in the margins, none of her trademark vertical folds to mark her place, and no makeup smudges like there were on the other scripts. I wondered for a minute if this was really her copy or if I had been hoodwinked. Then I turned to one of the very last pages of the seemingly untouched script and found this speech written in pencil in her hand on the back of a facing page. And that's it up there on the screen. Oh, why did you have to come back now when I'd nearly forgotten you? Do I have to go through it all again? The whole heart-aching business of forgetting you again. Well, I won't. I waited for you long enough. I gave you every chance. Now I've got a different life to lead. Go away, Jimmy. Forget me like I forgot you. Go away. Now, actors sometimes handwrite a speech to help them memorize lines they're having difficulty with. One can only imagine her feeling of having to act out what essentially become her life. Jeanette being Jeanette gives it her all, but her eyes in this movie give her away. They look dead. Broadway Serenade, to quote one reviewer, through no fault of the players, this must be one of the worst major studio films of a great year for cinema, 1939. Jeanette is charming as always. She warbles beautifully, and it's great fun to watch. Lou Ayres plays a nearly saintly husband, though with a temper, and the supporting cast is fine. The problems? Hackneyed script, and an incredibly tasteless and vulgar Bugsy Berkeley number to end the affair. Of course we expect Berkeley's numbers to be over the top. We just don't expect them to be so poorly designed. Jeanette and Nelson reconciled the following year during New Moon, and Katie will talk more about that a little bit later, but by the end of the 1940s, it all starts to unravel again. This is the second script I have, and you can see in this picture her holding. That's Pa Kettle, by the way, in case anybody doesn't recognize him. Her hands are all over it, as are her often poignant notes. Her name is scrawled on the front, along with a notation that it was mailed to her in Chicago on March 7th, 1948. The edges are ragged, the page is stained, and she has written extensive notes in the margins. The words are double and triple underlined for emphasis. What was going on in her personal life at this time. Her agitation is no surprise. Her attempt at having Nelson's baby had failed. Her relationship with him is on the rocks. She turns to Jean in desperation, trying to pick up the pieces of that relationship. It's around this time, according to her autobiography, she asks him if he loves her, does he want a divorce? He doesn't answer her. Take a look at this. She's struggling in general, and it spills out all over these pages, notes upon notes upon notes, trying to control what she can because so much of her life is out of control. She writes at least three times, I don't understand this. This confuses me. Jeanette always was a detail-oriented person, but she becomes absolutely fixated here. You don't see this in the other. This is also reflected in her personal life in this general time period. We see 50 plus pages of documentation on remodeling her home to Twin Gables. Pages and pages of her handwritten instructions, even drawings of where to place lamps on tables. The time and energy it must have taken on these infinitesimal details of this project is mind-boggling. I look at this and want to say, you're a movie star with a golden voice, Jeanette, not an interior decorator. But she can't control what's going on in her personal life, so she controls the hell out of what she can, like where the lamps go, on what table. It was also around this time that none other than Cole Porter himself sent her his new musical, Kiss Me, Kate, offering her the chance to originate a role which would have ensured her acceptance. Successful return to Broadway. which is presumably what she would have wanted, as that's exactly what she tried and failed to do with Gardner. So what does she do? She turns it down. This brings me to the last script that I was able to purchase. This was their proposed all around this time that Jeanette and Nelson are offered a script that was tailor-made to their talents. I have Jeanette's copy. The roles were perfect for them. It's a musical with Nelson as an aging and womanizing Broadway star with a talented teenage daughter, and Jeanette as the plain Jane music teacher Martha, who takes the girl under her wing, clashing with the father and undergoing a metamorphosis herself. It's titled Will You Remember, and it's simply fabulous. Lots of insider references to their movie musicals. In one scene, Martha overhears Jerry calling her a saggy spinster and a meddlesome frump with the squeaking shoes. His words force her to face what she has become, prompting her into action. The background music swings into tramp, tramp, tramp in time to Jerry's voice echoing frump, frump, frump. And we follow Martha's squeaking shoes over a rubber mat across which is emblazoned Elizabeth Arden. Martha's transformation from a stern, solemn pedagogue to a chic and elegant swan is depicted in a series of montage shots. So compelling is the change that when Jerry meets her again, he doesn't recognize her. Naturally, comedic and romantic complications follow, as an incognito Martha is tapped to take the lead in Jerry's next musical. This was around the same time when Fred and Ginger were reteamed in a very successful Barclays of Broadway. It was the perfect script and the perfect time for them to reteam professionally. Why didn't they do this now? The answer, I believe, was because their relationship was in shambles and Jeanette's sanity was hanging by a thread. She essentially has a breakdown and cuts Nelson off entirely. Finally, I want to show you some clips of news footage we unearthed and had digitized. This is from January 15, 1965, the evening after Jeanette's death. Nelson is interviewed by ABC. He's had no sleep. He's been all up all night talking with reporters. He needed to talk. He didn't have anyone else to talk to but reporters. You can see he's tired, breathy, and he's laboring to form his sentences. He's also in the middle of opening his act in Anaheim. The man's exhausted. Still, he manages to speak very well of his former partner under these difficult circumstances. This is Nelson in his own words. Listen to his voice soften.
Mr. Eddy, what is your first memory of Miss MacDonald?
Well, my first memory of her was like that of many, and that was seeing her in motion pictures, mostly with Chevalier.
Oh, yeah.
They were wonderful things that they made together, the last of which was The Merry Widow. And then I was given a contract to go to the same studio, and they said there was a possibility that we might do something together. It seemed almost too good to be true, and it was too good to be true for a couple of years because they didn't seem to hit upon the right thing for us. And then they did Naughty Marietta, which was a very successful picture, and it did a lot for both of us. And I was new and completely amazed at the business and just walked through it in a glow of wonderment and love and delight. And a little later I learned something about the business and it became more of a business. But that first picture, I was walking on clouds, there's no question about it. And she, of course, was greatly responsible for helping me so much in so many of the scenes that were difficult. I didn't know what was difficult. She did, but I didn't. And she was very helpful, and W.S. Van Dyke II, was the director who was responsible for putting us on and the way that we were put on. And this was my first introduction to big movies and a really big star.
When did you meet her? On the set at Naughty Marietta?
No, as a matter of fact, I met her in her own home. She gave a party following The Merry Widow. And, you know, one of those general Sunday afternoon get-togethers after doing a picture, you invite everybody over. And she knew that I had been mentioned as a possibility, and so she invited me too. And so this was actually the first time I met her was in her own home, and under personal circumstances rather than on a film. Then we made Rosemary after Naughty Marietta, and then we made Maytime and Girl of the Golden West.
This is sweet and humble, Nelson. He's not claiming to be an actor, though, so how come he was so convincing in those love scenes with Jeanette?
Those three first pictures bunched together were big successes, and when you put three good ones together like that, it's very good for you. And we made eight in all. I've only made 16 pictures my whole career. That's not many pictures as pictures go, but some of them went very well, and so I picked up the reputation of being a movie actor. And, well, let's say a movie singer. She did most of the acting, believe me.
Nelson talks about, in this clip, Nelson talks about those silly stories about a feud. Jeanette addressed this too in a notation in her autobiography. She thought those rumors were started by LB. That's what she wrote it in the note, the margins. When he says, "We never changed," I believe him. He said, "You heard him say that in the Christmas 1935 letter. I love you and will always be devoted to you." That never changed.
And the thing that stood out in my mind was after the preview of Naughty Marietta, the director came to me and said, "How does it feel to find yourself in this position?" I said, I don't know. It's wonderful. I just don't know how to act." And she says, "You're telling me." Well, she was always poking like that. She wasn't a practical joker, but we were always having our digs at each other, and they were very healthy. It was a healthy attitude. We'd fight like cats and dogs sometimes just to make people wonder. And we had to cut it out because people started to believe it. Mm. And even to the point of the publicity department coming in and making shots of us, fighting each other, knocking me down on the floor and everything, and the director calling me out, and the silly stories that come up about you. And we never changed in our attitude at all.
And this is my favorite story. He's getting tired here. He slips. The well-documented story he's telling happened during Naughty Marietta, not Sweethearts, and the director was Woody Van Dyke. Listen, I think he thinks she's pretty swell.
If there was one incident in all your career with Miss MacDonald, what would one incident you would remember about Miss MacDonald, what would that be?
I don't know, I guess it would be something funny. We were in Sweethearts, and she had a habit of taking a little too much time for lunch and going and watching the dailies from yesterday's shooting, and made the director mad. He was very strict. And finally, he made a call after lunch, and she wasn't there. Said, "Where is she?" Says, "She's watching the rushes." He said, "Good night, folks," and left the stage and disbanded the company for the day, costing MGM considerable sum of money, and put her in a very bad light, and she was very unhappy about it and didn't quite know what to do. The atmosphere was very tense, and The night passed and everybody got down there the following day. They said, we bet she'll be on time today, Miss MacDonald. So it came 9 o'clock and she hadn't shown up. Everybody was shaking. Director was so mad he couldn't see straight. Finally, four men came in, dragging in a doghouse. And the doors opened, and she got out of the doghouse. And the director roared with laughter, and everybody else roared with laughter, and she was immediately forgiven, and we went on with our shooting as though nothing had happened. And she's a smart, because she was always a smart girl, and I think this was the most wonderful way to get out of that thing.
She was always a smart girl. We like smart girls. I think Nelson likes smart girls, too. And finally, this is a small clip from Jeanette's funeral. The interview and the complete footage from both funerals are available on my YouTube channel or via links from MacDonald-Eddy.com or Katie's blog. Just as Sharon reported in Sweethearts, Nelson was the last of the honorary pallbearers out of the chapel. Watch afterwards as he is consoled like he's the widower. And watch Blossom as Blossom comforts her great-niece Nanette like she's her grandmother. Jean comes out of that chapel looking over his shoulder like the devil is after him. It's a very odd scenario. Okay. I see Nelson at the back. There's Sharon. Can you help me? Who is a okay. Jean comes barreling out, looking over her shoulder. Yeah. We don't know who that is. We think it's one of her elderly aunts. This is a closer. Yeah, they're coming out with the casket. Those are the pallbearers. And the interesting thing is some of the pallbearers were the same as Nelson's funeral. Z. Wayne Griffin, Lloyd Nolan.
Leon Ames and both.
Lawrence Melchior. Yeah. There's Jack Oakey. Nelson's at the back. There's Nelson. Yeah. It's a very odd scenario, as I said, yeah. There's Leon Ames and Melchior. And Nelson called this the most miserable day of my life. That was his quote to the Boston Globe. Then when they asked if he was going to be at the funeral, he said yes. I will be there. It will be the most miserable day of my life. The next slide we're going to show you. Nelson died 25 months and 23 days later. To me, the next slide is says it all. How anyone can look at that the change in him and not know this man loved her, is beyond me. There he is in 1964, and January 1965, right around the time she passed. And then the last photo was taken just a few days before he died. Jeanette and Nelson were clearly two very ambitious and career-oriented individuals. But this is what people clamored to see. Jeanette and Nelson performing as a team. This is where they had their greatest professional and personal success, together. Look at them. This is after their MGM days, and they still light up like Christmas trees around each other. No matter what choices they made or how badly they messed up in their personal lives, as performers, they were flawless. They left us with a legacy of beauty and music and movie magic that continues to enchant people to this day. They still have the power to touch hearts, winning admirers and fans globally. Blogs, YouTube channels, social media, CDs, DVDs, people still love them. I've had tens of thousands of hits on the videos we had digitized last year. In just a few short years, nearly 250,000 hits on all of my Jeanette and Nelson videos on YouTube. And the comments keep coming from fans all over the world. Google Translate has become my friend. Lots of them in Russian. They love them in Russia. Here's a small sampling of some of those comments. I had a happy childhood during the 1930s and 40s. It was such as this that helped to make it so. From Esther N. It's incredible, but here I am at age 96 and still never get tired of listening to those two sing their beautiful duets. Occasionally, when these same numbers are sung by other performers, I have to turn them off. It seems too sacrilegious for others to tamper with what should only be performed by Nelson and Jeanette. And finally, one commenter, Jim W., who sums it up for me. I love these two. When they sing love songs, they're really very convincing. Maybe because they really loved each other. Makes my old eyes well up. You can see it in their faces, and I think it is a wonderful and beautiful thing. May God give them a special place in heaven. Thank you for listening.
Hi, everybody. I'm Katie Gardner, and I've loved old movies in general since before I can remember, and I have my grandmother to thank or blame for the wonderful passion for this era and its people and culture. Happy hours of my childhood were spent playing dress-up with Nanny's old gowns and twirling in front of the television pretending to be Ginger Rogers or Rita Hayworth, and listening, fascinated, to her World War II stories of being in the Red Cross stationed in Burma. My love of this time in history has touched everything else in my life, from getting a degree in musical theater performance because I wanted to do what they did, to being a guest speaker for the National D-Day Memorial, which is in my hometown of Bedford, Virginia. I developed specific interest in Jeanette and Nelson around high school when I saw May Time. I stumbled upon the Yahoo group, which was then in its heyday, and Byrne sent me my first copy of Sweethearts, which was taken away from me in French class because I was reading it under the desk. I am so glad I made it to the right team of Jeanette MacDonald love because I cannot imagine how obnoxious I would be if I was on the other side. Because I developed such passionate feelings about an interest in these two people and their story, I began conducting some independent research, which I think is the responsible thing to do when you're trying to form an educated opinion. I got more serious about my research over the last few years, and recently Angela and I have made several trips to Washington, D.C. to the Library of Congress. I've harassed librarians from Pittsburgh to Greensboro to Los Angeles to New York, and I've somehow convinced archivists that I had more serious business than that of your average deranged fan. And I'm absolutely delighted, but not at all surprised, to report that every conclusion to which Angela and I have come thus far has absolutely fallen in line with and supported the pioneer research that Sharon Rich has done and continues to do. I am so excited that she asked me to speak to you all and share some of my research, which I really hope is adding to this story. For just over a year now, I've been keeping my own Jeanette and Nelson blog, and if you don't mind a little passionate language, mostly directed at one Mr. Raymond and his faithful band, my findings and frustrations and rants and research can be found at the link on the screen, which, if you can't read it, is singingsweethearts.wordpress.com. I'm going to cover a sort of eclectic mix of topics over the next few minutes, and I just decided to go through them in chronological order of when each thing happened, even though the events in and of themselves may not specifically be related to each other. Go ahead, next slide. The first thing I'm going to talk about is actually a fairly recent find, something that came to light this past December on our last trip to the Library of Congress concerning early production on New Moon and one of Jeanette's many radio appearances around this time. As we know, relations were quite strained between Jeanette and Nelson as they went into production in the fall of 1939. Nelson had made the unfortunate, irrevocable mistake of marrying Anne Franklin in January. Jeanette had subsequently attempted suicide, and they hadn't spent any time together. Woody Van Dyke, their dear and trusted friend, was the original director on New Moon, and with Robert Z. Leonard producing. But early on, Woody got pulled off the project to go expedite matters on I Take This Woman. Pop Leonard took over directorial duties. Variety notes that pre-recording the score of New Moon began on October 23rd. That was a Monday. In Sweethearts, Sharon notes that New Moon began on November 6th, which is also a Monday, 2 weeks later. Given these two dates, I think it's safe to assume that November 6th means principal photography, the start of shooting, in other words. 2 weeks for pre-recording seems like a legit window. In the manuscript of her doomed autobiography, Jeanette notes October 28th as the start of New Moon, which was actually a Saturday, and it seems less likely than the other two dates, which work together. But anyway, the ballpark remains the same. In the early moments of production, Jeanette was very professionally cool towards Nelson, not making a fuss, but not doing one iota more than she had to do, either. Nelson, desperate to make things right between them and reconcile with her, was trying all manner of things to break down her walls. He fouled up majorly, and he knew it, and he needed her to acknowledge his profound remorse. The thing I love about these two is it's never, ever about I don't love you or I'm not in love with you. Loving each other is never their problem. It's everything else that gets in their way. Even at their lowest lows, and they had some appallingly low ones, they acknowledged that they loved each other. She was preparing to record One Kiss, one of her solo numbers in the film, the lyrics of which are some of the most passionately erotic that she ever sang. And Nelson sent her the following note, which I copied from Sweethearts, but it is sourced from the Isabel Eddy memoirs. Sing even if you don't mean it. Sing it just for me. You can take all the time you want, but you are coming back to me. You have to. Meanwhile, remember this. My love for you is indestructible. No matter what happens, nothing and no one in all the universe can change or hurt it. Remember that. I'm pretty sure at this point they weren't hanging around for each other's solo recording sessions. Maybe during other films when they were trying to use any excuse to take some time together, but this atmosphere being what it was, I would bet that Jeanette either outright insisted on recording alone or just made sure it worked out that way. Variety states on October 24th that she had recorded her One Kiss solo yesterday, so Monday the 23rd. I'm guessing that Nelson hadn't heard it yet because he wasn't on hand for her solo sessions, but she would have gotten his note. However, on October 29th, a Sunday, Jeanette made an appearance on a radio show called Community Chest. And guess what she pulls from her repertoire to sing? That's right. Now, she could have chosen to sing One Kiss because she was rehearsed for it, having just recorded it the prior week, but what sticks out to me about this is the fact that New Moon wasn't released until June 28, 1940, which is a full 8 months after this. Additionally, though the Romberg operetta is called New Moon, The film version starring MacDonald and Eddy was originally titled Lover Come Back to Me. So, first of all, I think it's too early for her to be doing publicity for this movie that had just started pre-recording. After all, many projects get to the pre-recording stage and then are shelved or discarded. The fact is, according to the practices of the time, it was way too early in the game for her to be singing songs from the movie to publicize it. And since Lover Would Come Back to Me was the original working title, if she was doing this for publicity, why didn't she sing that? It would have been the title song. Or she could have easily sung any of the other number of songs she'd already made famous, so One Kiss is indeed a really interesting choice. We know Nelson and Jeanette use this kind of thing to communicate with each other. To me, it seems highly, highly likely that this choice was in response to his note. Think about it. How safe this is. He isn't around. He isn't physically there. So she doesn't have to talk it out with him afterwards or look him in the eye or get grabbed up in his arms when she knows she doesn't have the power to resist him. It's an olive branch, a safe olive branch from a distance. Consider how she looks in the film Wanting You. I mean, in the number Wanting You. She's all, like, professional actress face for the beginning of the number, and then we see her resistance crumble. We see her breathing like she's just sprinted a mile. And then we see that tentative, cautious hand reach out toward him, and with that, his entire performance changes and sweeps her along with it. This choice of song is like that hand. She wants him, she wants what they have, but she's scared of the avalanche. This recording had never been made available before I published it on my blog in December. We found it in the Library of Congress's collection back in June and submitted a request for it to be digitized. So here is Jeanette's October 29th, 1939 radio performance of One Kiss.
In this year of 1792, our conventions have been thrown out of view. And I know I'm out of date when I see one face I've never through. To be really in the fashion today, you must have a dozen boobs in your way. But somehow I don't believe in the modest man. I want to wait for just one man. One kiss. One man to say this all, one love for him alone. One word, one vow, and nothing more to tell him I'm alone. One
The next thing I want to share with you all is just some research I've been doing concerning Jeanette and Nelson's 1940 to 1941 winter and spring concert tours. They both made frequent tours at this part of their careers, and it usually worked out to about 6 months out of the year that one or both of them was on the road. I specifically honed in on this tour because one day as I was looking for something else, I came upon a clipping discussing Jeanette's concert in Roanoke, Virginia in January of 1941, and the fact that she stayed at the Hotel Roanoke while she was in town. That's about 30 minutes from where I live, and I'm very, very familiar with that hotel, so that was something I personally found really interesting. Then I recalled that Nelson was also in this part of the country in late January 1941 because he sang for Roosevelt's inauguration. And that's when I got really, really excited. As it turns out, I feel like I was right to be excited because what I found when I tried to trace the movements of these two around this time is very interesting. Indeed, a little too interesting to be purely coincidental. The first thing you need to know is that Jeanette started touring in November 1940, and her tour wrapped up February 28th of 1941 in Asheville, North Carolina. It was supposed to end on the 16th, but she had to make up two concerts that she missed earlier in her tour. That's crucial information, but just hold on. She went back to LA in early March and prepared to begin shooting Smilin' Through on March 26th. Nelson's tour kicked off officially on February 11th, 1941 in Tucson, Arizona, and went until April 17th. So all told, we're talking about 6 months of total time that one or both of these guys was away from California. And that's a really long time to be away from somebody you love. And these people did this almost every year for a while there. When Nelson got home, Jeanette was working on Smilin' Through, and he went to work on The Chocolate Soldier in June. So here's the fun stuff. January 18th, Jeanette gives a concert at Memorial Hall in Columbus, Ohio. January 19th, Nelson sings for the FDR inauguration. And Eddy was present for this, but she goes back to LA right afterward. We don't have any mention of Nelson leaving the East Coast until newspapers discuss him singing in San Diego on February 4th. Also of interest, an item ran January 25th listing Nelson's nominations for the 10 best songs for shower singing and general pleasure. I don't know what that's about, but there you go. In addition to The Road to Mandalay and The Star-Spangled Banner, he lists Ah, Sweet Mystery of Life and I'll See You Again, and wait for it, Drink to Me Only with Thine Eyes, which could not possibly have had anything to do with the fact that his girlfriend is about to sing that in her new movie. January 20th, Jeanette sings at City Auditorium in Huntington, West Virginia. She's about 5 or 6 hours away from Nelson by train at this point. She hops the train to Pittsburgh, where she's scheduled at Sirium Mosque on the 23rd. Now she's 3.5 or 4 hours away by train from Washington. And having already arrived in Pittsburgh after singing to rave success in Huntington, she gets sick and cancels her Pittsburgh appearance. Let me pause right here to point out that Jeanette was a total pro and very much the show must go on. To illustrate my point, you remember that time that she was performing in The King and I in 1956 and she literally had a heart attack in the middle of the show and she finished the show? Or how about the time she was throwing up during The Guardsmen in 1951? She was actually walking off the stage to get sick in the wings in the middle of the scene and walking right back on and continuing the show. Newspapers all pointed out that canceling this Pittsburgh concert on the 23rd was the first time in all of her national tours that she had not kept a scheduled date. So either she was really, really, really dying, or she was willing to do it to spend a day or so with Nelson under the radar. Since she sang in Roanoke 2 days later, with rave reviews, it was a 2-hour show and over an hour of encores, she was an exceptional voice, and she brought down the house, so I'm basically forced to think that she was not dying. As of January 22nd, her concert in Pittsburgh had not yet been canceled, but our girl was already on the train to Washington. She was in D.C. on the 23rd, the day of her canceled Pittsburgh concert, and was supposed to go on to Roanoke, where she was scheduled on the 25th, but funny story, she misses her train in D.C. on the 23rd. She misses her train
Does she not have people around her who can get her to a train? No, I feel like we all need to be, like, kind and understanding with our sweet little Jeanette right now. After all, it's awfully hard to make a train when you're being trapped by 6 feet of gorgeous baritone, am I right? According to the article, she's forced to spend another, which means more than one, night in Washington. You know, with Nelson in town and marry a spouse for thousands of miles. The article is badly faded and it's hard to read, but after detailing that she had to spend another night in Washington, it goes on to say that she didn't receive the press in Roanoke, and that she walked straight to the waiting car and was taken to the Hotel Roanoke, which is less than a mile from the station. After being a total sensation in Roanoke, she cancels Asheville, North Carolina, where she was scheduled on the 28th. Magic, sick again. She goes on to Florida, but we don't see or hear from her until she sings in the Municipal Auditorium in Orlando on the 31st. From there, she zipped down to Havana on the 3rd of February, where there was an uncomfortable political scene with President Batista being directly involved really close to where her concert was happening. This frightened her, and she left after the show to come back to the U.S., preferring not to even spend the night in Havana. All this time, not only is Jean Raymond well documented in Los Angeles, as is Ann Eddy, there is not one smell of where Nelson is or what he's doing. The only thing that seems certain is that he's not in California. No mention of his homecoming from Washington, which surely would have been noted in some paper by someone. No blurb about him being on a train or plane or anything. We only start hearing about him again in preparation for his concert in San Diego on February 4th. I started out only caring about January, but I found that, as always, knowing all of the background data enhanced the story significantly. You have to figure, if you're that close to your significant other, 4 hours by train instead of on the opposite side of the country, after that much time apart, and knowing you won't have the chance to see them again for months, it might well be worth it to you to postpone a couple of engagements to spend time with them, even if that is terribly out of character. Especially when you can do it that sneakily. I just can't legitimately see her canceling for a cold under these circumstances. In her autobiography, Jeanette made a lot of references to having a bunch of colds as a child, as a young adult, as a young performer, and she talked about her ability to sing over, under, and around her colds. So again, it must have been pretty important for her to postpone two shows. Her outstanding performance in Roanoke between bouts of being sick also belies any condition as serious as what the papers were talking about. Incidentally, she added Pittsburgh and Asheville onto the end of her tour, singing there on the 24th and 28th of February, respectively. And you know that candid shot that everyone loves of them on the set of Smiling Through? That one? That was right after he got home from his tour. If they hadn't seen each other much since their rendezvous in late January, that might explain these ridiculous grins and happy arms. I just really, really love the way they look at each other, and because of that, I want to share what is probably my absolute favorite candid shot of Nelson, Jeanette, and Woody Van Dyke on the set of I Married an Angel. We talk a lot about Nelson's adoring gazes at Jeanette, which are frequent and heart-stopping, but in this shot, it's Jeanette's face that's totally priceless. I just have never, ever seen her look at anyone else the way she looks at Nelson. I'm not going to say there are no cute pictures of her with Jean Raymond, because that's not true. There are plenty of nice shots of them where she looks like she's happy and having a good time. There are also shots where their tension is palpable and their lack of chemistry is appallingly clear. What I have never seen is a shot of Jeanette looking at Jean like he's the only man in the world and she can't wait to be alone with him. And that's exactly what we see here. Earlier this year, I was able to acquire Jeanette's script from I Married an Angel. That was the first of several of her personal items that have come into my possession, and the first time I had held anything that was actually hers. To have it be something like this, a tool that she used in her job with Nelson in a film that I love, at the greatest movie studio in the world, was just entirely too much for me to handle. Next slide. Oh, that's it. Okay. Here's the script with the two of them on the set, and the day I got it. I was pretty wildly excited and immediately watched the movie while following along with them to see how good they were with their lines. When I was doing that, I made a one-word discovery that I'm still freaking out about months later. These script pages are only printed on one side. In other words, when you have it open, there's typeface on the right-hand page and the left-hand page is blank. I've just lost my place. Okay, what I found is not actually written in the script, but rather it's an impression on the paper. Jeanette had another piece of paper on top of the script page and bore down on the script while she was writing a one-word note. That one word is tonight with a question mark. Think about this. Or change the slide. Go ahead. Yeah. And you can see the imprint of tonight with the question mark. And anyone else who may have been talking to her about anything, plans for who knows what, a party, a radio show, anything, she could have answered them out loud. The way I see it, the one person with whom it would be necessary to communicate about tonight by passing notes so as to remain under the radar would be Nelson. And Nelson wore glasses, but Nelson did not wear glasses in costume for this movie. So she writes her note in all capital letters, printed so someone who might be trying to read it on the sly would have no trouble seeing it. Oh, if that script could talk, what could it tell us? That's just one word, but that's a pretty great word if you ask me. The other script I have in my possession is from Three Daring Daughters, which was originally titled The Birds and the Bees. This one is much more worn than the Angel script, with more notes scattered throughout about dates for shooting things and dialogue changes and which dress goes with which scene. I took pictures of a couple of examples to show you. I was really happy to be able to have this script because this is probably my favorite of Jeanette's movies without Nelson. I just find her so warm and adorable with those girls. And when I watched the movie while following along with the script, I was really happy to note some MacDonald ad-libbing. She's much less careful with having her lines exactly right in this movie, though generally I think what she says is better than what's written. What I loved, though, was the fact that at least half of the endearments directed towards the girls, the honeys, darlings, babies, sweethearts, were not in the script. That's just Jeanette being sweet and lovely and adorable, just like we know she is. Jeanette, a major Eisenhower enthusiast, campaigner, and champion, also had the honor of performing for both the 1953 and 1957 presidential inaugurations. In 1953, she gave a concert, and in 1957, she sang the national anthem. We found the audio footage of her 1957 national anthem at the Library of Congress. We had it digitized in June of last year, and we recorded it when we went back to December, so you can all hear how she sounded that day.
In the grand march in honor of the President and Mrs. Eisenhower and Mr. and Mrs. Nixon, we haven't seen them yet. They're not going to be here, as we just remind ourselves, at this juncture in the evening. The Vice President will be attending one of the other inaugural balls. And now to the podium. At least you will hear the sounds of the music coming over our microphones. I think the next on the program will be the national anthem, after which we'll have a chance to see the celebrities.
Oh,
would be a little bit better, but it's that old. And she was in fantastic voice. As a side note, when I was leaving Washington in December, the taxi driver who took me back to the hotel, or to Union Station from the hotel, was a much, much older man. And as we talked, he told me that he had been driving a DC cab since Eisenhower was president. I told him that the lady I had been researching actually performed at both Eisenhower inaugurations, Jeanette MacDonald. He nodded and smiled and said, "Oh, I remember her. Red hair, beautiful voice." The last of the Library of Congress discoveries that I will share is also from 1957. In doing a search for any television or video footage that we had missed, Angela and I happened upon this tiny gem. This is the only known footage of Jeanette performing in concert at the Sahara in Las Vegas. Though it is silent, if you watch her mouth, you can see that she's singing "I Love Paris." Loves Paris in the fall, and then "I Love Paris" in the winter. And there's Jean taking a bow for doing nothing as usual. Just a couple of weeks ago, Angela, Maria, and I went in on a partnership to secure Jeanette's 1963 desk diary. It was offered for sale on eBay in the auction we've been talking about. The first thing that is immediately clear upon examining the pages, and she wrote on every single page from January 1st to November 1st when she went to the hospital in Houston, is that the last 2 years of Jeanette's life were not happy, easy, or pleasant. It's a harsh reality, but it is reality. It's a little difficult to imagine what on earth she and Jean would have to fight about at this point. She's retired from almost all but the most rare personal appearance. She's a wealthy woman. She's footing the bills. He has his Air Force activities and the occasional small acting job, and can come and go at leisure, which he does, and always with men. But fight they do, more than just a couple of times. She marks Jean's comings and goings regularly, and he is more absent than present, leaving for days and weeks at a time, and in one case, he's gone for an entire month, from February 25th to March 23rd. They have meals together so infrequently that she writes it down when it does happen. The word "alone" is written in this book more times than one can count, and it's shockingly clear that she eats little and she sleeps less. She was 5'5" tall, and her weight dips to 97 pounds during this year. And it usually hovers around the 102 to 106 pound mark, which is far too light for a woman of that height. She is unwell often, sees doctors constantly, and in general seems like someone who should not be spending long stretches of time by herself. Not only does this feel like something that isn't safe for her, she writes of dizzy spells and one time where she cannot speak, which, by the way, Sharon reported many years ago. But it's heartbreaking to think of this social, chatty woman with nothing but an appointment book for company. Aside from attending church or going to the movies, often with her sister Blossom, and scattered, though infrequent, dinners and appointments, she comes across as bored, sad, and tired. On January 26th, she writes that she made the mistake of going to Jean's bed with indifferent results. Apart from the fact that this illustrates for the umpteenth time over the course of their marriage that she and Jean did not share a bed or a bedroom, the fact that she wrote down this rejection is just really sad. I don't even necessarily think that she was in pursuit of sex. I think it's likely that she couldn't sleep, she saw his light on, and she just wanted some company. The fact that he doesn't appear to give a damn is just shameful. What kind of spouse is that? Change the slide. On a happier note, on February 25th, Gene catches a plane for New York, where he would remain until March 23rd. And the next day, February 26th, Jeanette writes the single most enthusiastic and happy word in this entire book. Visitor, with 2 exclamation points. Naturally, we all know who we think that visitor is. So we checked Nelson's movements around this date and found that, much to our delight, he was between bookings and in Los Angeles. The other thing that makes this even more affirming is that she doesn't refer to anyone else in vague terms like that. Everyone else she meets, dines with, visits, etc., is listed by name. She is very detail-oriented in much of her writing, and this diary is no exception. The day after her visitor arrives, she cancels her 11:30 appointment, but makes a note about taking a sun bath. One hopes she was not alone. Then, one wonders if her visitor didn't stick around, because March 1st, she has a morning appointment to get her hair and nails done, and then she writes, "Wonderful day." Rather ironic that the happiest times that are noted in this desk diary are when Jean Raymond is on the other coast. Change the slide. You know, it's sort of strange to have access to these things, to these private thoughts and notes 50 years after she died, but I find, in addition to the protective feeling that I know Angela and Maria and I have discussed, particularly in relation to the desk diary, this access brings with it a huge responsibility. The fact is, these items have been in the possession of people who not only hid the truth, did not want the truth to be known, but went to great lengths to smear and destroy anyone who tried to talk about it. It's a tradition that sadly carries on to this day. So often I hear the naysayers asking why on earth we are still adding pieces of the story at this late date. Well, the answer is very simple. We wouldn't need to be adding pieces to the story in the year 2015 if people had been honest from the beginning. They weren't, so here we are. And I have to say, I can't think of anyone or anything more deserving of our group's time and attention than clarifying the story that she lived but couldn't talk about. With Jeanette, I think we frequently wish that things in her life had gone differently or better, and I think we'd all love to go back in time at key points and help her or warn her. But the thing that I find is the deeper I dig, the more I care about her. And my constant discovery is that the real person, the brilliant talent, the patriotic citizen, the shrewd businesswoman, the determined, keenly intelligent professional, the sassy smart aleck, and yes, the prima donna iron butterfly, is so much more fascinating and wonderful than any golden comet cooked up article ever allowed her to be. That's the best thing about being in this club. We allow these two incredible people to be flawed human beings. We regret some of their choices just as they regretted some of their choices. But we consider them to be worthy of praise, accolades, and continuing research and discovery just as they are. We don't need to place them up on some ridiculous, impossible pedestal to understand that they are both incredibly special. Thank you.
Thank you.
This was a long presentation today, but I hope you found it informative. We usually don't go on this long, but so much has come to the foreground. Yes, I want to say also just very quickly that I haven't really had a chance to even look through that diary properly, but I found a couple things in there that just shocked me because they were exactly what I had written, and there it was in her handwriting. I mean, there's one example I just have to say where I wrote how she would call Nelson occasionally hysterical. She thought she was dying or whatever, and he'd drop everything and come home. And then you look there and it says hysterics. She wrote hysterics, and I'm like, oh my God, you know. There's a couple things, there's a name of a person who comes to see her that I mentioned in the book, who was a friend of Jean's, and things that went on in the house, and it's, the guy's name's right there. I mean, it's just, it was shocking. And in a strange way, I mean, it's kind of, you know, I feel vindicated because it's there and my sources were correct. On the other hand, it's just ever so much more awful to see it in her own handwriting and to think that any fan off the street would have been thrilled to come over and say, hey, I'll have lunch with you, I'll sit with you, I'll take care of you, and she just had nothing. I mean, it's just unbelievable. Anyway, all right, so I want to thank everyone for being here today and for all the participation to put this whole presentation together. I don't know what is happening with this place, whether it's just next door that will be torn down and turned into a mall. I don't know if the hotel is being left alone. So just stay tuned and we'll see whether we meet here in December or not. Assume yes unless I say otherwise, but again, I don't know, they are tearing the whole thing out, and so the restaurant as it was in the pond with the swans, you know, etc., are not going to be there anymore. But anyway, it is what it is. We'll see where we are in December. Okay, so thank you all for coming, and have a great summer, everyone. Thank you.